This replica deck reveals where tarot started. This is the Visconti deck, also known as the Visconti Forza deck, and it is built off of an actual game that the Italian Visconti family hired somebody to create for them. This author, Rachel Pollack, who's a practitioner of tarot, is probably one of the strongest fixtures in the community that I have read about. I've read a few books on tarot. Her book, 78 Degrees of Wisdom, A Tarot Journey to Self-Awareness, is an amazing deep dive. It goes into all the nuances of the symbology, as well as the history, and the link to mysticism, particularly the Kabbalah, that comes when you study tarot. Even though we do know there really isn't evidence to suggest that it was built off of anything to do with the Kabbalah, but there are so many parallels. And I recently found out she wrote this second book about the minor arcana specifically, but you do get both in this book. She has quite a wealth of knowledge. So today we're going to look at just a brief selection in the introduction of the book where she discusses the origins of tarot. Around the middle of the 15th century, not so long after the first written references in Europe to cards of any kind, an artist named Bonifacio Bembo painted a set of unnamed and unnumbered cards for the Visconti family of Milan. These pictures comprise the classic deck for an Italian game called Tarocchi, four suits of 14 cards each, plus 22 cards showing different scenes, and later called Trionfi, in English, triumphs or trumps. Now, of these 22 images, many can be interpreted as simply a catalog of medieval social types, such as, to give them their later names, the Pope or the Emperor, or else common medieval moral homilies, such as the Wheel of Fortune. Some represent virtues, like temperance or fortitude. Others show religious mythological scenes, such as the dead rising from the grave at the trumpet call for the Last Judgment. There's even a card depicting a popular heresy, the image of a female Pope, which we can describe as a joke on the church with rather deeper significance than most ecclesiastical humor. Still, we can view this heretical picture as deeply rooted in popular culture and therefore obvious to someone representing medieval types. So one of the things that makes tarot so powerful are the archetypes that are seen within it. So what exactly is an archetype? Well, an archetype is kind of like a symbol of human experience, but it represents one aspect of it. So for example, you might have the authoritative father, the stern one, much like the emperor, or you might have the nurturing mother archetype, much like the empress, or someone who is very steeped in tradition and religion, such as the Hierophant. This card deck is actually a replica of the tarot card deck that came from the Visconti Tarocchi deck. These ones are quite pretty because they have the gold foiling. And I'll tell you what, there's nothing I love more than a finish that shines or sparkles. Most people are more familiar with the Waite Smith deck made by Ryder. Arthur Waite designed his own cards, and reason being, he wanted the symbology to be representative of what each card had. Now, the reason he redesigned it, even though some of the images are very similar, here you can see his 1909 version, well, the update, of course, because holographic finish, who doesn't love that? But his 1909 version of it, the reason he had it updated was to include more symbology that kind of aligned with his beliefs, with his membership in the Golden Dawn Society, but also because the trump cards, while they do contain images and symbols, the pip cards, which are the minor arcana, there's 78 of them, tend to actually not have the images these do. And he wanted to make sure to really bring out the characteristics of the card. And so he had Pamela Coleman Smith design these cards. That way he could direct what kind of colors he wanted as symbols, what type of objects there were, and basically, you know, his expectations could be met in a way where he could read the tarot in ways that helped him to better intuit what was going on. Now, one other difference is that in
this, I want to say the Smith deck, but in Waite's deck, he did change two of the cards, the positions, the numbers, right? Because numbers are symbols as well. And so he did switch, and he put strength as this card, the eighth card, whereas traditionally it was justice. And then he flip-flopped that again. So here we have justice becoming the 11th card. Well, the 11th card of the Taroki-inspired version is actually strength. What a funky little lion, huh? I kind of feel like this lion is a little more, less creepy. You'll notice that of the minor arcana of the Visconti cards, the court cards actually do have images. So the page, for example, which might be called a knave, the queen, etc. But the pip cards here, whether it's pentacles or cups or whatever you're working with, chalices in this deck, you'll notice that while it shows the pentacles, they really don't have scenes like you would find in Arthur Waite deck, such as the Three of Pentacles in this particular one. One thing to remember if you feel a little nervous about starting with the tarot is that the tarot is all about intuition and using what you see in the cards as a way to kind of psychologically analyze a particular condition. And the reason these work so well are because of the archetypes and because of the human experience. And it really brings together all the different meanings that we encounter throughout our lifetimes, whether they are meanings that are tragic, meanings that inspire hope, or meanings that show maybe the next direction to go, or perhaps not go. I'll be doing more of a series on looking at each major arcana card. And if you're interested, drop a comment, because I can also teach you how to choose which of the major arcana cards actually represent you, your very own signifier. It's very easy.